pottery, ironwork, weaving, painting, and more. This week, as we visit an artist retreat. We were invited to what was being billed as the Pocosin Arts Cabin Fever Reliever, an artist retreat at the 4-H Center near Columbia. The retreat was sponsored by Pocosin Arts. Their executive director, Feather Phillips, first told us about Pocosin Arts.
Pocosin Arts is we're a private nonprofit educational center. We have an interdisciplinary mission. The abbreviated mission is connecting culture to environment through art. We're all about the Pocosin region, this place. And I think many of your audience might not know what Pocosin means. Pocosin is an Algonquian word. It means swamp on a hill. And it defines a particular upland swamp biologic community. And when Pocosin Arts began, we are not associated with a county. We're a regional organization. And so we say, how do we say that? And then how do we let people know in the name of our organization that we are about this place and that we are about the people of this place and the kind of the spirits of this place? And so we chose the word Pocosin and of course arts so that people know how we're getting to learn about people, place, who are you, where did you come from, what are your arts, how do you express yourself through art, and how can we find out more about this place through the investigation of that. So it's kind of a big mission. But we do this in a studio in downtown Columbia. We have classes and workshops. We have an outreach program in the Tyrrell County Schools. We have an education gallery showcasing the work of regional artists. And we have a sales gallery. So we're offering the opportunity for regional artists to showcase their work to our new visitors.
You'll find many different folk artists working at Pocosin Arts.
In our education gallery, we have work of regional artists. It's a lot of kind of folk art. It's not fine art in terms of what might be produced through the university setting. Although there are a lot of university trained artists who have the heart of folk artists. So the work is kind of primitive. We often show the work next to the natural materials that are used. We have a local folk artist, Roy Smith, who does folk painting, memory paintings of his time as a boy in Tyrrell County. He also creates for us artifacts that were in his home growing up. He did a beautiful yarn gourd for us, which is a big bulbous gourd with a large opening at the front and then a tiny hole drilled at the top, and Mama kept her balls of yarn in there, and the single yarn was threaded out the top, and then when she was knitting, the yarn didn't roll all over the floor. He also did a yard broom for us made out of reeds that we gathered together on the ditch bank. I think of another of our artists, a fellow named William Baxton, an African-American self-taught carver from Washington County, and he goes into the swamp and he'll cut, he tells me he goes into the cut down. So after an area has been logged, he'll go in and find the saplings that have been knocked over, but they're not dead yet. And he'll take, he works with gum, he works with juniper, Atlantic white cedar, he works with maple, swamp maple. And then he makes the most beautiful carved walking sticks. He also does tables, masks, and other sculpture. He's a very special artist. We have another folk artist, a woman named Desi Norman from Pea Ridge, also in Washington County. She digs her own clay, and she forms these heads. Some of them are kind of mysterious, and this is an African tradition. She's connected to a number of artists in the Mississippi Delta region who dig their own clay and create these heads. So when we display works of these artists from different cultures, we hope that the community who comes to visit us has a better understanding of who's here And, you know, I never knew he could do that. Isn't that something? Maybe I have a newer appreciation. So we're hoping that through this exhibit and our classes and our performances and our workshops that we bring the community closer together through the arts. And I know that works because it worked for me in public schools.
Feather shared more of her dreams about how the mission of Pocosin Arts can have a positive impact on the community.
We hope that through this mission, we can address the following social issues: racism, poverty, environmental degradation, and singularly linear thinking. Through the art, the music, the dance, the craft of each culture, allowing everybody to express their culture's traditions, their culture's strengths, that we open new understandings of each other. We're hoping that we can help develop skills of expressing these cultures so that our local folks can then take this expression to market, either in performance or in produced craft that might be sold in a gallery, or through teaching, storytelling. So that's the economic development part. Environmental degradation, Pocosin, we invite people from other places to this place, and we say the swamp is not a place to be disposed of. It's not a place to be filled and paved. Pocosin has a mystique to it. This area has its own beauty, and it's less dramatic than the ocean. It takes a certain calmness and perception to get into this place and appreciate its wonder. The other thing we're trying to do through our education program is encourage interdisciplinary kinds of thinking. And so in public education, our teaching has been pretty linear. You went to math class and you engaged a certain set of skills. You went to science class. There was a tremendous overlap there between math and science, progression, this kind of stuff. In the art room, things are processed differently. They're processed very often from the whole. And giving credence to imagination, intuition, many other disciplines are very fact-oriented. And there is so much research now validating the whole brain approach to learning. And quite frankly, with sort of the bloom of the information age, there is so much information. When you package it for students, if we continue on this linear path, there are not enough hours in the day. So what we as educators have to do is we have to find ways to package knowledge and information in an interdisciplinary way. So they're learning about science and math, and they're creating a product. They're synthesizing all that information. They're creating something, and then they're, through the whole process, they're holding it.
The 4-H Center and the Artist Retreat came together to make a dream come true.
When we first started and opened our studio in 1995, Columbia was, there might have been 9 boarded up storefronts. We got a second floor walk-up studio. And the vision was there. We were going to bring in artists from everywhere, and we were going to enrich the community. It was all there. However, we had no place for people to sleep. There may have been one bed and breakfast. There may have been one restaurant and a hot dog stand. And so we said, well, we'll build the program. We'll start small. We'll build the program, and we'll work it out. Well, simultaneously, North Carolina 4-H was developing the Eastern 4-H Environmental Education and Conference Center. And I'll never forget this day. This was in 1994. I was mailing 120 letters to people around Eastern North Carolina who I felt might back this mission. And I was looking for letters of support for my first grant. And I was licking the envelopes and folding these letters. And my father-in-law was visiting for the weekend, and he was helping me. and the local newspaper was on the table. And the headlines said, Eastern 4-H Center to open. And he read the article, and he just read my letter, and he said, Feather, if this center happens, you've got it. And so I began, originally we were going to build the campus. We were going to build every building. We would build the dorms. We would build the glass studio. We would build everything. And then the state of North Carolina, and through tremendous effort and dedication of our local 4-H extension agent, Francis Falava, and others, the Eastern 4-H Environmental Education Center came to be. It opened in June of 2001. And we are here at our first residential, traditional craft, art, music retreat. And our community is about 85 strong. And the dream is happening.
Now into the classroom. Randy Hodges is the village blacksmith of Manteo and Columbia. He demonstrated the craft of blacksmithing in a context authentic to a time about 100 years ago. His work is primarily ornamental ironwork, and his demonstration projects included such things as nails, hooks, door pulls, and fire pokers. He believes the blacksmith trade is an important part of our heritage and is very much grounded in rural culture. Alexis Joyner is a professor of art at Elizabeth City State University. His participants were introduced to basic carving techniques. Each created a personalized walking, talking staff. Robbie Hodges used a painterly approach to introduce her students to rag weaving. Recycled clothing, select found objects, and other remnant cloth was the medium. Color and texture were the main focus of this experience, along with a touch of personal exploration. Petey Brigham is one of the Mid-Atlantic region's most accomplished landscape painters. The natural retreat environment was perfect for her learning to look walk as a preface to painting. Students worked from abstraction toward realism. We found Master Potter Ben Owen III, a third-generation North Carolina potter from Seagrove, leading students through this wheel-oriented workshop toward an enhanced understanding of proportion and shape in clay. He demonstrated techniques for throwing and emphasized sculpting. Margaret Fluke teaches weaving, quilting, and surface design at Maryland Institute, College of Art, Baltimore, and Towson University. In this class, her students explored several resist dyeing techniques, including clamping and chemical dyes and discharge solutions. They also examined stamping and painting with chemical dyes. Fantasy, emotion, and memory were the inspirations for this studio in polymer sculpture. Students worked with Bill Nelson to create a character with a head and glass eyes and easy ears. Whether they were destined for the Grand Old Opry, or teachers encouraging their students in their classroom in the art of musical presentation, veteran performers Gary Mitchell and David Tweedy of Molasses Creek helped their attendees hone their skills and expose them to the world of professional folk roots music. I hope you've enjoyed our visit to the Eastern 4-H Environmental Education and Conference Center in Terrell County for the Artist Retreat hosted by Pocosin Arts of Columbia.